scraggly hair was now just a few inches above his shoulders, and he had a hint of shadow across his chin. His khaki pants had been traded for tattered jeans, and his eyes carried a sadness nearly as heavy as mine. Are you all right? Should I be asking you the same thing? I shook my head. I'd never been worse. Dumbfounded, he knelt in front of me as if he were trying to make sense of my presence. He ran his hands over my arms, checked my injuries. Even as miserable as I was, his concern for me made me feel infinitely better. You're drenched. Did you fall off a boat or something? Please tell me you didn't go for a swim in a prom dress. I shook my head again. You don't look like you're bleeding. Do you think you have any broken bones? No. How are you even here? I'm so confused. He continued to stare. I don't even know what to ask next. Do you have anywhere to go? No. He poked his fingers into the grass, fidgeting, deciding. Okay, then come with me. I cleanly rose and held out a hand. I stared at his uncut nails, the dirt still clinging to him. I should not be near this boy. I just committed an act so unspeakable that if I could use my voice, I'd cry for days. I was isolated from my sisters, estranged from the ocean. I was so, so deadly. But what else could I do? Brush him off and say, I was fine when I clearly had been through something. Hop into the water, though I couldn't stand to be near her right now. I could stay for a night. Once I was settled, I would come up with a plan. So I slipped my cold hand into his and let him guide me home. I sat at Akalini as he walked. His hand was on my back, leading me to his house, and his palm felt rough and calloused. His hand was no longer handling books, but something much sturdier. He seemed weathered, less buoyant. Why was he still here? He should have been at school. It's nice out tonight. You couldn't pick a better evening to go and get yourself lost, I mean. Look at that moon. Perfect night for getting lost, don't you think? I couldn't help but smile. It was as if we hadn't missed a beat. As if I hadn't left him so coldly and vanished without a word. I thought about you a lot. He continued without looking at me. When you disappeared, I was really worried. He swallowed. I tried to find you. But all I had was a first name. The school had no record of anyone going by Galen, enrolled as a student, and I couldn't find you online. It was almost like you never existed at all. Yet here you are. Panic ran through me, my chest tightening. How was I supposed to explain without creating a bit of lies I'd inevitably fall into? I breathed deeply, trying not to lose it. Should I just run? If I disappeared again, I could make sure he never found me. He looked me over. What was he thinking? What was he guessing? Undoubtedly, the truth was too far-fetched for him to imagine, but I sensed he was trying to pull all the pieces of my story together, and none of them fit. He finally spoke again, quiet and a little wistful. I kept hoping you'd come back to the library. I dropped my eyes and put my hands together in a pleading gesture, trying to make him see how sorry I was, and that I hadn't wanted to hurt him. It's okay, he said, his voice brightening. I wasn't mad. I was worried. Just nice to know you're not hurt. Well, I hope you're not. Come on. He turned us towards a two-story house covered in pale blue paint with black shutters. It looked like his only neighbors had settled in for the night. The light of their TV flickered against the curtains. On the other side of his house, the land turned and the road followed. I could hear the sounds of waves crashing nearby. I was sad not to have you around, but I don't blame you for disappearing. I disappeared myself not too long after. I watched him confused. What could have happened? We walked up the steps and across the porch, and he drew his hand across his face. Since the wife away sorrow, Julie, he called, opening the door. But I'm no coffee, we've got company. Julie's my cousin's wife. He told me she was a volunteer EMT in college, so you're in good hands. The front room of the house was the kitchen, and I wasn't sure if Julie was expecting to see when she rounded into the living room, but she stopped in her tracks when she came upon me. she was acting as a mother in this house. Luckily, her eyes widened in sympathy. What can we do to help you, she asked. If we can't call the police, can we take you somewhere from the hospital? I'll be fine, I wrote. I'm just stranded at the moment. I clasped my hands in front of me, thinking as Julie read what I'd written. I knew what I wanted, but I didn't know how to ask. I clearly scooched around, reading my note over Julie's shoulder. What if she stayed here with us, Alcalini asked. Julie looked up at him, startled and bent brown. I'm not sure that's a good idea, he said in a whisper, as if my muteness also made me deaf. I'm not comfortable with a stranger in the house. But she's not a stranger, Alcalini said. I told Julie, we know each other from school. Look, I even... He pulled his phone, fumbling with buttons. See, that's her. I'd almost forgotten about the one picture I'd sent him. Snuggled in, heaven in my bed. Ben made a face, agreeing that I was in fact the same girl. While he was clearly still skeptical, Julie seemed mollified. Are you sure you'll be okay here? She asked me. Do you have somewhere to be? This all felt incredibly awkward and biting myself into their home, but I didn't see another option at this point. I couldn't just walk out into the night as if nothing happened, and I couldn't let them hand me over to a police officer or a paramedic, and it was highly unlikely that I'd ever get to spend a night under the same roof as Alcalini ever again. I shook my head and wrote, I'd like to say, if you didn't mind, just for the night. She frowned worriedly, clearly still concerned, but nodded. If that's all we can do for you. She still felt tender and fragile, haunted by what I'd done, but I looked at Alcalini and smiled. After some debate over where to put me, Julie decided I could sleep in the spare room, and she set about making up the sofa bed, then brought me a pair of pajamas. I was grateful for something to wear that wasn't made of ocean, despite them looking a little too big. There are more blankets in this closet if you need them. Even though it's spring, it can get cold up this far north. Not sure if you're from Florida or not, so yeah. Julie stammered, filling the uncomfortable space with words. Also, I put a cup and a new toothbrush in the downstairs bathroom for you. If you think of anything you need, just let someone know. I nodded, grateful for the kindness. The true gift she gave me was time, but that she thought of a dozen other niceties made me feel incredibly fond of her. She nodded and then placed her hands on her hips. This is a bit weird, isn't it? She asked, gesturing to us in the room. I grimaced and nodded. Well, weirdness aside, you can stay here as long as you need. Any friend of Alcalini's is a friend of ours. Haven't seen too many of them lately, she admitted sadly. So you're a welcome change. Julie smiled, and I had a feeling that she and I were on the same side, for at least the time being, and that made me like her even more. I'll let you get ready for bed. Good night. When she closed the door, I looked at the wide window that faced the ocean. She was calling out to me. Where are you? Are you all right? I rolled my eyes. It wasn't as if I could die. She knew that, so I ignored her and slipped into Julie's pajamas, pausing to roll up the legs. I emerged from the room to find Alcalini on the couch, in pajamas of his own. I was so happy to see him waiting for me. Hey, he said, standing. You've got food if you want. I signed it. No, forgetting that he didn't know sign language. But he remembered the gesture from our date and continued. Okay, do you want to watch some TV? If you're tired, you can just go to bed, but I was going to sit here for a while. In the light of the lamp, I noticed the shadows under Alcalini's eyes. He looked much older and more experienced than he had 6 months ago, but the same warm acceptance showed in his gaze. I couldn't stay, I reminded myself. I would have to leave tomorrow, go back to my sister's. I could only allow myself one day with him. I didn't want to go to bed. I wanted to spend every ordinary moment I could with Alcalini. Maybe I could pretend just for the night. I nodded and we settled onto the couch together. I pulled up into a ball to cover myself up. I felt so insecure in Julie's clothes. Alcalini mistook this posture for coldness and pulled a blanket off the back of the couch and messily spread it over me. He hardly even acknowledged that he'd done it, just swept it down and picked up with the remote again, making the volume louder. The channel was clearly sports-focused, and the current game featured giant men in tight clothes. Alcalini noticed my puzzled expression and laughed. It's a strong man competition. These things cracked me up. We watched as men carried refrigerators, lifted huge boulders, and flipped massive tires in strange races. I watched, slack-jawed, as the competitions got more and more bizarre. By the time the first man came up to a pull an eight-wheeler into motion from a standstill, I was pointing at the screen, shaking my fingers wildly. I couldn't believe any human was that strong. I know, he cried out. It's crazy. I nodded a giddy smile on my face. Watching TV had never felt so normal. After a few contests, he lowered the sound. He seemed nervous, flicking his eyes between the television and me as he started. he's going to did something else that might bother you. I know they were a crazy bunch, but I shook my head again, pointing to the pin at my chest. So, what, you just had to go? I nodded, a little embarrassed. He squinted. So, it was you. You alone. No one else made you go. I swallowed. The ocean's rules were the catalyst, and her deeply possessive nature was in the back of my mind. But it had been my idea, right? After some consideration, he pursed his lips as if he were storing this information. You know, there's something else, he said solemnly. You never told me your favorite color before you left. I grinned and shook my head at this ridiculous boy. So many, but mostly I like the color of autumn. The color of autumn, he repeated slowly. Yeah, how everything looks like it's on fire. Oh, that's my favorite too. But it's dying. Death never looked so lovely. He chuckled. Excellent point. I like a good blue myself. Maybe because I grew up on the water. What else? Favorite food. I made a face. Cake, obviously. Oh, I can't believe I missed that. And by the way, a few months ago, I was in a store and saw how expensive almond extract was. You should have been charging per slices. Yikes. Nah, I was happy to share. Well, maybe we should have been less eager. I got harassed for more treats up until the day I left. Seriously. So, just let you know, you broke the heart of the entire second floor in Trappist Hall when you left. They were crushed over the loss of cake. I appreciated Akalini's teasing. I had been afraid that he'd been mad or bitter, knowing that he'd mostly been worried made being back beside him so easy, too easy. Oh, here's a good one. I think this says a lot about a person. Favorite smell, I consider for a moment. I'll go first if you like. I love the smell of fresh cut grass. I gave him a thumbs up because that was a good one. I heard that the smell's actually the grass trying to say it's in distress, which makes me a little sad about it, but it's still really, it's still really good. I took up my pen. So what does that say about you? Enjoys the outdoors, yearns for freedom, willingly mows lawns, he laughed. All of the above. What about you? I flipped to the next page. It wasn't until I started writing it down that I realized the memory had even stayed with me. It was like a special gift from all this time. Any flowers? My mother used to like to have fresh flowers in the house. So not even specific, just any flowers at all. Akalini's smiles faded as he read over the page again. Wait a minute, used to. She doesn't anymore. I closed my eyes, realizing I'd been thoughtless. I had intended to let him know that. Is your mom gone? Looking down at my hands, so I wouldn't have to be drawn to lie, I nodded. Your dad? I nodded again. How he breathed as if he was almost afraid to ask. I felt numb for a minute. Recalling the carpet, my mother watching herself in the mirror as the boat heaved. They drowned. I'd said the words before, but never written them down. It was much harder to face in print. I preferred to think of it as an accident. Though the images of murder at the ocean's hands or suicide at their own were the ones that tried to force their way to the front. He let out a breathy sound, almost like a laugh. That's crazy. There was a long pause as he sat there staring at anything in the room but me. A few weeks after you left, I got a call from my mom, which, you know, was no surprise because she called me every day. But even from her just saying hello, I knew something was wrong. He paused, swallowed, and stared, twinkling with his head on the couch. She had cancer. It was pretty serious, and I wanted to go home right away. They wanted me to finish the year, so we compromised, and I went home at Christmas break. Dad was adamant that I was going back to school, and I wasn't sure I could, even after whatever happened with Mom. I didn't want to leave him alone, you know? He looked up at me, and I gave a tiny nod. I did. I understood what it meant to stay. I was supposed to be with them, he said. It was all he could do. It was all he could get out before looking away again. He tried not to make a big deal of wiping away the tears in his eyes. Mom had a doctor's appointment and Dad was taking her. I was going to go too, but Mom, I'll never forget, she told me to stay every time. I tried to argue about it. She insisted I stay. Sometimes I wonder if she knew. He stared at me. At nothing, haunted. It was rainy, he continued. The roads here can flood. Sometimes if it gets bad. The police weren't sure if my dad saw a deer just hit the bad patch, but he swerved right into a tree. I covered my mouth, eyes brimming. I'd been bracing myself for Mom, but losing them both at once, I wasn't ready for that. I crawled across the couch, sitting next to him, scribbling on a pad. I should have been with mine, too. He squinted. Did you nearly drown? I nodded. He sighed. Looks like you nearly drowned again tonight. He wiped a tear in the corner of my eye. Seems like water isn't your friend. I drank. a husband, a father, and what would I be? And what would I be? A teenage girl who'd spent the last century killing and running. Now penniless, nameless, and pointless. I signed to know, snapping my fingers together, and it was a relief that there was one word between the two of us that needed no translation. Okay, well, I'll be out here if you need me, I nodded, and hey, he added quickly, shoving his hands into the pockets of his sweatpants. Even though the circumstances are weird, it's nice to see you again. I smiled as I turned and went into the room. Without Akalini's jokes and laughs to distract me, I could once again hear the ocean calling for my return. Just a few hundred feet from the water, I was too far away from her to find me. Where are you? Your sisters are worried. Come back, Kaylin, come back. I lay on my bed, listening to her go on, the anxious tone implied, her wringing her hands and pacing like a mother who'd lost her child in a crowd. Well, maybe now she could understand how all the friends and relatives of the people she'd devoured over the years had felt. Besides, she was being dramatic. Where could I go? It wasn't as if I could die without her help. Come back. Where have you gone? Why aren't you answering? She pleaded endlessly with me. I would. Of course I would. What else? What else could I do? I heard the door to the spare room creak and pretended to be asleep, hoping I could pull off looking like a normal person for just a few more hours. I felt a warm hand touch my forehead and then my cheek. I held my axe steadily, though. Akalini's touch made me feel more than awake. Where in the world did you come from, you beautiful, silent girl? He whispered. After a long moment, I heard him slowly creep out of the room, quietly closing the door behind him. I pressed my lips together, wanting to cry. He touched me before in passing, but that brush against my cheek was so incredibly tender, it was almost impossible to take in my first life. I'd never crossed paths with anyone I wanted to be with, and I had no promise that I would want. I had no promise that I would once my sentence was up. So why here and now in this frozen, useless time did someone have to make me feel this way? I couldn't keep him, and I couldn't even be sure how deep this feeling went, though I sensed he was as curious about me as I was about him. This was bound to be a disaster. I couldn't stay forever, but at least I could stay for